The industry is totally collapsing.
Let me bring in Robert here. What does your agency do? And because I'm sure for you, you are interacting with the factories and certainly the market. How did we get to this point and what could be the problem?
Thank you. First, I must observe that we are members of the Uganda Tea Association. And by extension, definitely we are key stakeholders in the tea sector. I think what's critical, what they have mentioned, what Nicholas and Victoria have mentioned, is exactly what is happening with our factories as well. But what's most important right now is for us to appreciate what is actually the crisis. And Nicholas has alluded to that. The crisis is that the prices of tea have fallen drastically. I was doing a quick calculation, 150 over 60 cents on average for what Ugandans are fetching, 250% drop in prices over the last 1 year. Now, that goes to the root of every operation, that you need cash to be able to run your operations. And what Victoria and Nicholas have mentioned is basically every vital organ of running the operations of tea is affected, right from the raw material provider, the farmer, the estate, the one who works on that estate, the workers, they're affected. So if we looked at this as a human body, things are beginning to switch off. You're failing to pay electricity, they are going to disconnect you. You're failing to buy diesel. Eventually, all these vital organs will switch off, and then we will close.
Just of course, like the nine
have already closed as you reported in one of your media outlets. So the crisis is about tea prices being down. Now, we come to ask ourselves, how did we get there? And that is something that, as Nicholas said, at some point, government needs to come in. How did we get there?
Victoria and Nicholas have actually alluded to the fact that they are having challenges, especially of the cost of production. Now, this is a universal problem. Mm. It is not a challenge only in the tea factory or in the tea sector. Mm. Could we just look at, of course, what could have led to the drop in price? Because these are the challenges that you'll find even in the cotton, in coffee, in whatever, you know, production sector that you look at. What exactly led to that drop in price? Let me start with you, Robert.
Now, we operate in our world market is called Mombasa. Okay, that's where we carry out our auctions. 90% of all Ugandan teas goes to Mombasa. So it's a regional market, but it's the world market. Everybody around the world buys tea from Mombasa. So what happened at Mombasa?
Exactly.
Mombasa mainly deals in black tea. They have most recently started looking at the other products of tea, to whether they can be able to deal in orthodox teas as well, but it's mainly black tea. Our main black tea markets during this period have been suppressed. And that's the first thing that led to the crisis that we are facing now of low prices. Now, which are these key markets that were suppressed and now we are suppressed? Pakistan buys over 40% of the teas that is sold at Mombasa market, the auction. Egypt buys over 12% of the teas that are supplied at Mombasa market. The UAE, same quantities. UK, about the same quantities. Now, those five, Sudan, not South Sudan, Sudan, the main, Khartoum. Khartoum also buys a significant quantity of teas, about 6% of teas that we trade in the auction market annually. Now, 6% of these traded in the auction market would almost represent the entire production of a country like Rwanda. Mm. Maybe you add on to that a bonus, you would be Rwanda and Burundi would constitute about 6%. So we produce about 15%. Mm. Now, each of these countries has experienced a certain level of crisis in their own countries. Well, let's start with Pakistan. Pakistan had political crisis, and then they had the economic crisis arising out of political led to the economic crisis.
Yeah, that's true.
But then they were hit by a calamity. Floods hit Pakistan heavily. So they lost their rice crop, they lost their cotton, and therefore the textile industry lost a lot. The rice sector also lost quite a bit. So their exports went down. And it meant that dollars that were coming into the Pakistan economy also went down. Mm. So about 2 years ago, they started rationing how much dollars you can actually get to be able to import goods into the country. Mm. And that affected tea in a very big way.
Big way. I want to bring in Nicholas. Mm. Robert has actually well explained what exactly is happening in Mombasa, but of course there have been issues to do with quality of your production. Mm. What has that also contributed? How does that also contribute to the reduction in price? And what remedies have you put in place to ensure that this is actually addressed?
Yeah. Quality is a very big issue and a determinant when it comes to tea. Mm. When you look at the Mombasa tea auction, where we all take our teas, for example, all East African countries, you find that the quality of teas from Rwanda, from Kenya, is a bit high compared to this one of ours in Uganda. One would ask, why is it that Kenya and Rwanda, they have high quality, and you Ugandans here, you don't have what?
Oh.
High quality. But quality is attributed to so many things, but mostly it is the fertilizers. Because when you see Uganda teas, the industry lacked a lot of fertilizers. Russia, as a country, produces a lot of fertilizers which we tend to buy from. But when you look at the current situation in Russia, the wars between Russia and Ukraine affected it to the extent that the prices of fertilizers went high. So you find Ugandan factories are unable to cope up with the price.
Mm.
Back in like last 2 years back, we are buying a sack of fertilizer of 50 kilogram at almost 85,000 shillings. But when you go to compare right now, it's at 245. So you find like the factories are unable to do what?
To get those fertilizers.
And the fertilizers, remember, are very, very, very key in determining
the output. Mm.
So you find the quality that we are taking to Mombasa cannot compete with those in Kenya, Rwanda, and other countries.
When milk, for example, when dairy issues came up with Kenya, and of course, with Kenya rejecting our dairy products, government was actually saying that we need to look at alternative markets for our milk. Isn't there an alternative from Mombasa, Victoria? And we find a way out of how to deal with certainly with these prices and certainly the consumption of tea.
Thank you, moderator. There are alternative markets that of the factories to sell their teas to. However, there have been a lot of issues with the way business is being done there. We've had cases where we've sent some of our colleagues, some of the factories have sent to the, normally you send the sample, it is approved, and it is the tea from which the sample was drawn that is taken. That's how it ought to be, because there could be some inconsistencies in production. So you find that there are sometimes when you are doing business with these foreign markets, and you send your samples and they get approved, when you send the consignment it is rejected, the guys that it was not the same as the sample that was sent. So we need a bit of, we need interventions there with bilateral agreements and maybe an agency that will help to coordinate and resolve some of these conflicts that are happening. So most of us have depended on the Mombasa auction, because it's easy, first of all. All you have to do is, I mean, if you have your brokers, you have a warehouse that you've contracted to warehouse your teas, the buyers all collect there from all over the world, so you don't have to go out looking for the buyers. So it was easy, but with the ongoing situation, we definitely need to look into alternative markets. Then the other issue could be the standards. Acquiring some of these standards is a bit difficult for some of the factories, so you find that you can't penetrate most of these markets without the standards or without the certifications that your teas qualify to be consumed by these markets.
We have actually been reporting that from about 750 Uganda shillings to about 150 a kg on a kilogram on the farm gate. Let's take a look at about 5 years before. How has this been happening? I mean, how have the prices been actually going down? You know, about 5 years, we have gone through COVID and all that. Mm-hmm. Is there some, you know, what has been the trend? How has been actually the trend in terms of prices? Let me start with Nicholas before I come to Robert.
Actually, if you talk of the period of COVID, I will say we were lucky.
You were in business.
we were lucky that the prices didn't go too much down as how it is right now. We were at least we were in position to sell above our cost of production. And we were lucky that for us, we continued operating even during the time of COVID, because being an agricultural sector and here in Uganda, we were allowed to continue operating.
You were considered to be one of the special groups that were supposed to be working.
Absolutely. And when you look at our average price, was almost at $1.46, which was okay, at least above the cost of production. And there we were not complaining. And things were moving on well. And the fact that we have now come out, this explains that things were moving
well,
although not that we are in position to meet each and everything, but at least. But right now you can see we have come out to say, please, this is what is happening in the tea industry. Otherwise, if this had not happened, maybe we would be there. And for your information, I think this is the first time, if to me, I've ever seen tea coming out to make all these cries. You have seen all the articles in the media, different medias, papers everywhere, that please, 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 we are going. And we have been making this alarm sometime back, and we alarmed and said, please, the industry is going. So to me, right now, if you compare the current situation and
the previous ones,
this is the worst.
Let me bring in Robert. Of course, people are talking about intervention, government interventions, and of course incentives here and there. How much would it actually contribute to a reduction of your cost of production, for example, if power goes down? Or it should be a combination of many incentives, much more than just power that has been raised.
Yeah, it's many incentives, just more than power. Victoria and Nicholas have alluded to the fact that quality now remains our biggest challenge. There is a lot of market out there for good quality teas. That's why Rwanda and Kenya are still able to survive in this market, despite that suppressed market out there, Pakistan, Sudan, and so on. Our kind of quality of tea made it in the Sudan market. And when Sudan had conflict from about 2 years, 2 years ago, when they went into all-out war, that's when it went completely to zero. The demand for our quality of teas went down to zero. And there's a lot of poor quality tea out there. So there's glut of poor quality tea, and there's very little supply of good quality tea. So I will tell you for a fact that there are factories in Rwanda that are fetching $5 today. $5 for a kilo of tea.
From Mombasa market?
From Mombasa market. So there are a number of things that need to be addressed. Now, this same quality of tea sold well during that period. Nicholas is saying our prices were 1.46. It was about the same quality of tea.
Yeah.
Nothing significantly changed. Because that's about the time when fertilizer application became difficult. Actually, just to go back a little bit, fertilizers, the prices started going up astronomically during COVID because there were huge logistical disruptions in the supply of fertilizer into Africa and of course, into Uganda. Mm. So the prices started going up astronomically about that time. Then when the source of the raw materials, Russia, Ukraine went into war, then it just multiplied the problem. Okay? So we he has already said fertilizer is absolutely important, but as important as the kind of planting material we use in our sector, what planting material do we have? What kind of teas do our farmers, do our estates have? Are they still the old seedling tea that are known to be of low productivity and poor quality? Mm-hmm. Or they are researched, newly researched clonal teas that have high productivity and of very high quality?
I thought you should.
Today, today, Rwanda is probably anywhere between 80 and 90% clonal teas. That is good material with high productivity, good quality. If you go to Kenya is now about 60-70%. Mm. They even did a pruning of their teas to replant with new clones that were researched either in Kericho or Tokla in India. The research delivered them those clones. Mm. And now what we are planting today, we are planting only clonal teas. But that only takes us to about 30% of the teas we have. 70% still seedling tea, poor quality, low productivity. So we have issues that I think at some point the policy for developing the tea sector needs to be put in place. Then there must be regulations to regulate the sector to a certain extent so that issues such as quality can be addressed even at the level of government.
Now that actually you're mentioning about what government should actually focus on when it is intervening in the industry, let's take a short break, but when we return, let's look at the possible interventions and remedies that actually can be provided to ensure that this industry is saved. Now it is one of the biggest, you know, foreign exchange earners for Uganda. Let's take a short break. We are returning in a short while. Good morning.